Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
To everyone, I would like to greet Reverend Jeanette Krieger especially and thank her so much for joining us this morning, and especially online, which I'm sure is not something you've really done a lot in your time, but I know all the ministers are very quickly learning how to do these things. So just very quickly before we start, there is the readings for this morning. And the notices, please remember that Reverend Storia Satishi is still on long leave, and we thank all the guest preachers we have this month. And we're so grateful that we can continue worshiping online as well. So all meetings and services will continue online. Please remember to look at our website, our Facebook page and YouTube channel, because we have a lot of information there, and we try and keep connected that way as well. And if you would like to join the WhatsApp group for communication, please let the office know. We can put you on. The link is actually also in the notices. And we thank everyone for their continued support financially during this time as well. And then it's over to you, Jeanette. Thank you so much.
Good morning, friends. I come from Hearties. And of course, like you, due to this raging COVID, we can't meet in our churches. We can't meet in our churches at all, but we are still gathered as church, as the people of God, and we meet and share in heart and mind as we come to worship. And we remember God is with us. Let's draw near to God and ask God to open our hearts and our minds to receive all that God has for us today. We begin with reading Psalm 139 from verses 1 to 10. You have searched me, Lord. You know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. Let us pray. Gracious God, you know us so well. All our thoughts, our dreams, our hopes. You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. We are comforted by the knowledge that no one understands us better. O God of unfailing love, we have confidence and we come in confidence, knowing that you will not reject us. That you continue to hold us, even in these times of turmoil and uncertainty, pain and sorrow. Encourage us again as we worship. Draw us to know more deeply the sure and steady hope we claim in resurrection life, and the knowledge that your constant love is always with us, and you love our world too. Deepen our assurance, trust, and confidence in you. Give us the gift of peace and deep joy as we hear and respond to your gospel today. You know the lofty ideals and the good to which we aspire. You know we strive for goodness, justice, and truth. But you also know we fail and are fearful. We have mixed motives, pain and confusion. Our weakness and the multiple temptations we face to do wrong, you know, O Lord, we condone and enable evil. Forgive us, gracious God. Have mercy on us. O Lord, may this time of worship touch our lives and the lives of those whom we meet. Help us to hear and obey your call to share your great love for the world in word and deed. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see you more clearly. We want to love you more dearly. We want to follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen. The gospel reading for today is from John's Gospel, chapter 1. reading from verses 43 to 51. I read in the New International Version. Jesus calls Philip and Nathanael. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee. Finding Philip, he said to him, "Follow me." Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nazareth! Can anything good come from there? Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, "Here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus said, "You believe me because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You will see greater things than that." He then added, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. Once again, we can't hold our in-person services. We started meeting again at our church under strict COVID protocols. Some people didn't come back to church after that first lockdown. And we're not really sure if they'll come after the second closure. Some people are worried about the future of the church. But before we join them in worrying, let's remind ourselves, our lives and the future of the church are in God's hands. God will complete the work God began in and through the church. That's what really matters. In the meantime, as church, we must live and witness to our Lord Jesus Christ. We must be the church, the people of God, wherever we find ourselves. Part of this means we have to take seriously our God-given privilege and responsibility to invite people to come and see Jesus, just as Philip did. Firstly, Jesus found Philip, and then he invites him to follow. Sometimes we imagine we are the ones who seek and are rewarded by finding God. But let's remember, God always takes the first step. Long before we are even interested, God is seeking, knowing, loving, longing for us. Jesus finds Philip and says, "Follow me," an invitation Philip gladly accepts. He sees in Jesus the promised Messiah who would bring God's reign and put things right again. "Follow me." That invitation is not only for Philip or those first disciples whom Jesus called, but for you and for me. Today, Jesus still invites us. Come, follow me. Have you accepted this call? It's not about an assurance that you're going to get into heaven one day when you die. It's about new life in Christ, becoming God's co-worker in this world, so that God's kingdom, God's rule and reign of love and justice finally come on earth as in heaven. Now, it matters very, very much whom you choose to follow, whom you allow to influence your life. Choose wisely. You and I are invited to follow Jesus. He alone is worthy of our full allegiance. Many people have been convinced they were following someone worthy, someone who would deal with their problems, fulfill their dreams. But instead of liberating them, we know that many so-called leaders have been self-centered, self-proclaimed messiahs, prophets, pastors. They have abused and used their followers for their inflated egos, their lust, and their personal bank balances. Be very careful whom you follow, to whom you give your admiration, your devotion. Especially be very, very careful if they expect you to depart from your God-given common sense or your thinking abilities. Many lead others astray. They are false messiahs. And there were many, many false messiahs in Philip's day and in ours. No wonder the friend that Philip tells about Jesus is initially skeptical and questioning. Philip is so thrilled with Jesus. Immediately he goes and finds his friend, Nathanael, to tell him about Jesus. He just can't keep Jesus to himself. When last have you been excited about Jesus? When was the last time you shared Jesus with someone? Can you think of someone you need to find and share Jesus with? Discovering Jesus as Messiah can never be just a personal thing, a private thing. The real Jesus of the Gospels always, always calls us into community, to love God, not as a private affair, but also to love others as ourselves. It's not ever only about personally being saved. We are called to take a unique part, a part that only you can take, a part God has for you in God's great rescue operation team. Now, Nathanael's initial reaction was doubt, actually prejudice and stereotyping. Nazareth, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Now, don't you know, Philip, Messiah is supposed to be a king, carpenter's son. Oh, no ways. From a backwater like Nazareth, no. Now, if you told me he was from Bethlehem, David's city, or at least an important place like Jerusalem, well, maybe I'd be interested. Nazareth. Nathanael doesn't even want to know anyone from Nazareth. He readily assumes nothing good is coming out of Nazareth. This makes me stop in my tracks. In what ways do I have assumptions and prejudices that stop me from seeing something new and fresh in God's plans? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Can anything good come out of our present contexts of pain and violence? It was shocking to witness the ferment of rage and violence in Washington recently, and the ongoing investigation uncovering even greater threats than we first imagined. Can anything good come out of our struggles, such struggles of brokenness of Washington and many places of the world today? We who profess belief in God really know that God has the capacity to restore and resurrect. And God longs to reveal new ways of love and mercy, healing and hope. As Debbie Thomas, theologian, said this past week, there is no place, no time, no circumstance, no situation that is beyond God's ability to redeem. So we have to say yes to that question. Can anything good come out of the present struggles that we are living in our world? The pain, the hardship, the illness, the death, the corruption, the racism and crime. God is still with us. And we live in hope. We live in hope as we serve God who knows. Remember our song? God knows, God sees, God loves, and God calls. So with Philip, we simply must take our responsibility to share this hope. Like Philip, let's find someone and say, come, see Jesus. Come and see Jesus, Philip said. See for yourself. In spite of doubts and reservations, Nathaniel goes along with Philip. And it turns out to be a life-changing moment. He sees Jesus. Still today, people are changed when they see Jesus. Faith, hope, and love grows as people are introduced to Jesus and are so excited and grateful that they begin to share Jesus, inviting others, come and see. A rich woman visited Calcutta and met Mother Teresa. She pulled out her money and was very surprised when Teresa said, put your purse away, come with me, come and see. They went to a very impoverished part of Calcutta, and there they found her, a small, sick, hungry child. Care for her, Teresa said. The woman lifted up the frail child onto her lap. She wiped her face and gave her some food. Mother Teresa spoke again. When we care for a child, we are caring for Jesus. When we love the unloved, we are loving Jesus. All Teresa had said was come and see. And that powerful invitation changed that woman. But sometimes we see with our eyes, but we don't really see. Come and see. What would we see if we ask God to help us see as God sees? When you look at people, what do you see? What kind of people do you see? Let's pause and ask God to see people differently. It's so easy to despise others, to think they're inferior. What do you see? Whom do you see? How do you see? Of course we see people with flaws and failures, but still made in God's image and therefore precious human beings. So Philip invites Nathaniel, come and see Jesus. What kind of Jesus do you see? Some see only a Jesus who gives personal salvation, assurance of heaven, piety and comfort. A Jesus who's somehow strangely divorced from the challenges and responsibilities of real life, of justice, integrity, honor within communities. And yet Jesus calls us to become like healing salt, getting rid of rot and serving the least as if we were serving him. That's the real Jesus. That's the Jesus of the Gospels. Do we see the real Jesus of the Gospel? The Jesus who urges us to be partners in God's kingdom project, to bring about God's rule of justice, peace, and righteousness on earth as it is in heaven. Do you see this Jesus? Many people co-opt some anemic form of Jesus for their own agendas, even for unholy purposes. And history is scattered with examples of people who have claimed to be Christians while violating, or at best, just simply turning a blind eye to the poor and needy. Do we have the courage to see the real Jesus? Jesus who came to seek and serve those who are lost. The shepherd who longs to bring the one home to God. The one who not only comforts but has compassion on us. This Jesus will deeply disturb our complacency and call us to the uncomfortable task of taking up our cross and following. Will you dare? Will you even want to see the real Jesus? Today I pray that we will open our hearts and allow Jesus to gaze deeply within and see what we really need, how we need to be challenged at our core. And then Jesus will surprise us, as he did to Nathanael. Did you notice from the reading what Jesus said to Nathanael? Jesus mentions his truth and integrity, that he saw him under the fig tree. And that's a traditional place for prayer and meditation at that time. And as a result of that, his cynicism and doubt just melted away. I wonder how different it could have been if Jesus had said, well, you know, Nathanael, you're full of doubt and you're prejudiced and you could do with more tact. Would be true. But Jesus named in his would-be follower qualities he wanted to bless and grow in Nathanael: his honesty, his good intentions, his hunger for God. What a huge difference it would make to us if we stopped and asked God for a fresh vision before judging others. We can all do with a fresh insight into each other in South Africa today. So many people see others as objects of race, class, culture, clan, occupation, education, and we fail to see people as unique, living, potential-filled creations of God. O Lord, give us grace-filled eyes to see the world and others as you see them. God, give us grace to see, to identify and name, to own up and eradicate our own prejudices and biases, so that we can get rid of them instead of trying to see with planks in our own eyes that skew our vision of others who are different. May God enable us to seek with all our hearts and minds and strength to develop a fresh view of Jesus that helps us to be excited and ready to share Jesus like Philip. Come and see. Then Jesus will surprise and stretch us. You haven't seen anything yet. There's so much more. You'll see a ladder with angels ascending and descending. And immediately, as Jesus speaks those words, we think of Jacob on the run from his brother, a stone for his pillow, trying to sleep. But God was in that place. The assurance, you've not seen half the glory that awaits because God is here. And so, dear friends, even while we're running as hard as we can from COVID, God is with us. God is with us. We've only had half of January and already people are weary. But God is here. God is with us. And if we have a look at all the promises of God, there's going to be a surge of splendor and glory, wave upon wave of life in all its fullness, fresh new grace upon grace, as we follow and see more of Jesus. Let's ask God to open up opportunities to share Jesus, to invite others to come and see Jesus. Is there someone who comes to your mind whom you can invite to come and see Jesus? Pray for that person. Pray for that person by name for at least 6 weeks. Ask God to show you creative ways to relate to that person, to share Jesus in deed and word, to do kindnesses to that person. Ask God to help you model the good news of Jesus in your life, so that you show the beauty of Jesus in your life, your deeds, your words. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, open our eyes to see Jesus, the real Jesus of the Gospels. Thank you, Jesus, you not only comfort us, but you challenge us. You call us to love God and our neighbors. You show us how to share your love in word and deed with those with whom we come in contact. Help us and place on our heart a specific person for whom we can pray regularly and share your message and demonstrate the difference your gospel makes in our attitudes, our actions and our words. Holy Spirit, open up opportunities for us to share Jesus and give us the boldness and the courage to use these natural opportunities to serve others with kindness and meaningful discussions. O Comforter, draw near to us and those who are suffering at this time. We come to you with our fears and tears, and we plead for relief from the suffering. This strange virus has curbed our freedom and robbed many families of their loved ones, robbed our children of their normal routines and school life. Lord, have mercy on us and our world. We bring to you those who are ill and those who care for them. We bring to you those who are on the forefront of fighting against this invisible virus that ravages our lives and livelihoods, not only here in South Africa, but in almost every country in our world today. Bless the efforts of those who serve, that seek to find vaccines and care and bring relief and healing. Draw near to those who are dying and those who grieve. Be with those who serve in public emergency departments, in shops and malls at a time when it's dangerous for them to be exposed to potential virus carriers. We pray for those working hard at this time to do what they can to help. But Lord, we admit that sometimes we feel anger and despair when we think of the many lies and conspiracy theories circulating, as well as the rebellious defiance of those who refuse to do the basics to keep this virus at bay. You alone know the depth of our hearts. You discern our true needs. Touch us again with healing and resurrection hope. Thank you for the confidence we have in you, the Lord of sea and sky, God of the universe, Thank you that you promise to be with us always, and we rest in you. We ask for your guidance in being church wherever we are. We ask all these things in the strong and powerful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to give the blessing now before the last song. Go in peace, go in joy. Come and see Jesus. Go and share Jesus. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
People in my heart, I will.